I am the earth, the cosmographic. I'm achieving equilibrium in astral palladium. The space, what creates canvas with a cranium that debates it for an hour. Chamber catered to fit a foot traveler. Talent and balance after practice in what you conjure.
Welcome to Freethinker Radio. My name is Derrick Broze, and I'm here with Micah Jackson.
Hello, hello, hello. Glad to be here. Got an exciting show.
Yeah, tonight. Busy show as usual, but exciting. Lots of guests. We have three guests so far, and hopefully some of your calls today. Just ahead of time to let you know if you want to call in, 713-526-8737. And, of course, you're listening to Freethinker Radio here on 90.1 KPFT Houston. We're here every Monday from 3 to 5 p.m. And today, the show will be followed by my other show with John Vibes, Addiction Free Radio. So if you want to hang out and hear that one, stay tuned after our show from 5 to 6. And if you want to follow along with what we're talking about, we have a Facebook event, do we not?
Yes, we do. FTR
featuring Adam Kokesh and Rhymes with Orange?
Yep.
It Rhymes with Orange. Or you just go to the Freethinker Radio page on Facebook. You'll see our posting about the most recent event and follow along in there. We're going to post all the articles and links to everything. But yeah, those are some of our guests. We're also going to have another guest here in a few minutes. I actually need to send him the call-in number. Oscar Yetzira, who's calling the show. He was supposed to call in last week to talk about the fight against the Dakota Access Pipeline. I discussed how me, Oscar, and Ryan had been to North Dakota to go support. Well, Oscar helped lead really this rally and this protest, this march this Friday, this last Friday, at the downtown headquarters of Energy Transfer Partners. It went really well. We had 100 plus people out there, I'd say, and the cops stayed away. They were there, of course, but they stayed away. They didn't bother anybody. And we put out a video on the Houston Freethinkers YouTube channel. If you want to see that, at youtube.com/Houston Freethinkers, go check that out and see it for yourself. But it went really well, and Oscar's going to call in about 15 minutes or so to tell us about another action that took place this morning, and we're just going to talk all about the Dakota Access Pipeline and that whole situation, so I'll save those details till we talk with him. And then around 3:30, we're going to be talking with activist, author, and longtime friend to this show, Adam Kokesh, who is on his tour, another one of his tours across the country. This one is called For the Love of Freedom. Freedom is, of course, his book. And he'll be speaking tonight in Houston, or not tonight, excuse me, on Thursday night in Houston. But he's calling in today. I think he was in Austin recently. He's somewhere in Texas right now, but he won't be in Houston till Thursday night. And he'll be speaking at the Midtown Bar and Grill. So, you can find that event also on Facebook. And we'll be talking to Adam today about what his tour has been like and see what else is on his mind. And then later on the show, we're talking with Gene from Rhymes with Orange. So, should be a good show all around. And as I said, we want to take your calls, 713-526-8737. And of course, if you're listening to this and you appreciate what we do and you appreciate 90.1 KPFT, you're always encouraged to follow our social media, Facebook, Twitter, YouTube. And if you like this show right now, go share the listen link, kpft.org/listen. Or if you're in one of the newer cars, you have that little HD button. You just press it and then they're like 90.1-1. And then you go to the next one and that's where we are.
That's it.
That's us.
Yeah, definitely. I appreciate all that because it's a, everybody's got a network and we're trying to reach as many people as we can with the stories, the articles, the messages, the different shows, everything that's going on with KPFT here. Speaking of which, there's a poetry fix presented by Christy Loy and Robin Davidson, and it's a at the Fix Coffee Bar. I don't know much about that place, but you can get into it. It's hosted by KPFT, so figured I'd go ahead and get that one out as well. All kinds of things going on this week, and guess I'm going to step into some of them. You mentioned that Adam's speech is going on Thursday night. Well, Tuesday night, you can get into Dylan Trim's free show over at the Nightingale Room. If you haven't been there, it's pretty nice place. It's kind of interesting, and I think it's probably going to be pretty full that night. Also, Kino Sims is playing along with the clergy and Shmoo at Warehouse Live. I keep getting shorts going. Whoop, whoop.
It's just in our ears. Nobody else can hear it.
Okay, good. Yeah. And I saw that Pluto is, he has a thing going on at Matchbox Gallery on Friday. And I'm about to lose these headphones. And Yeah. Bad Kids to the Front. We spoke with them before here, and Astrogel Rhymes with Orange, who we'll be speaking with today, has a show coming up Friday at Dan Electro's, along with Murder Boss Death King. And what about this name? Mouse Cop. So that should be a pretty full spectrum of interesting music to get into.
We haven't even mentioned, though, that we're giving away tickets today.
Oh, yeah. We're giving away tickets today to Houston Open Air, and you want to talk about 35 bands. Wow. Yeah, that's 35 good acts. I heard someone say they were going to go. I won't even repeat it. I can't say it. But somebody didn't like one of the acts, so they expressed the concern.
Oh, I saw that, too. They were just being...
But, you know, I think if you don't like one of the acts, the others make up for it. Avenged Sevenfold, Alice in Chains, Deftones, Slayer.
A lot of cool bands. Me and Mike are excited, though, because we get to go hang out, and we're going to go cover the event, get some video and audio to bring back to the station, and... play for you guys, and it'll be on the YouTube channel and all that good stuff, and just hopefully get some interviews with these musicians and people at the
festival. Some interviews with you
if you're there. Yeah, and talk to you. So today, the thing is that we've been asking people the last week is just to share the picture, literally just the flyer for Houston Open Air, share as many places as possible, you know, from our page, Freethinker Radio, and I've been seeing people share it out there quite a bit. So throughout the show, I think we're going to start counting these numbers, and we will announce who shared it the most. And I guess if you're still sharing it now, we can count those
until
the show's over.
Yeah, well, at least... No,
maybe,
wait.
Well, maybe 4 o'clock. Let's say till 4 o'clock.
At least till 4 o'clock.
Okay, yeah. So if you're still trying to win the tickets... And
it's within reach, honestly.
It wasn't shared a whole lot.
Yeah, I guess people didn't understand because maybe they don't get the breadth of this. You get tickets... a pair to both days, not just one, you know, and you get to see all these acts, and all you gotta do is share it a bunch of times. There's enough groups.
Absolutely. Yeah. So yeah, lots going on, and we're trying to get you guys a chance to go in to check out this awesome show.
There are four Texas bands on there: Texas Hippie Coalition, Mothership, I forgot who else, Sons of Texas, and I think one other. But yeah, there's all kinds of interesting acts on there, new and well-seasoned.
Well-seasoned. I like my music well-seasoned.
Yes. Ministry. I mean, they've been making music since the 80s.
And yes, Slayer's been around a long time, too. So yeah, lots of cool stuff. I want to save a little bit of the local talk so we get more of the local talk as far as action with when we get on the phone with Oscar, because that's been some busy stuff. But another thing that happened last week that I do want to mention that is also on the Houston Freethinkers YouTube channel, maybe in a little bit we can play some of the audio from this. I mean, it's a busy show, so we'll have to wait. But either way, go to youtube.com/Houston Freethinkers. And as I said, there's a video of the action from this past Friday. But also before that, there is an interview with City Council Member Jack Christie. And I attended this screening of the documentary Vaxxed. We talked about this a couple months ago, how this story had a particular, you know, Houston played a particular role in the story because of censorship. The film was, of course, supposed to be released at the Tribeca Film Festival, which is co-founded by Robert De Niro, the actor. And he basically was promoting this film, said he thought people really needed to see it. And at the last moment, it got pulled from the Tribeca Film Festival, and it was a big thing. And he temporarily pulled his support back, but then came back and said, hey, I do think people should still see this. Then the Houston International Film Festival picked it up, World Fest, and they were going to play it. But again, apparently the mayor, somebody from the mayor's office, stepped in and told the head of the International Film Festival not to play the documentary. So they again pulled it. And since then, the people behind Vaxxed have gone on a campaign to sort of fund their own tour of screenings around the country using the internet and, again, decentralized technology through different websites. There's a few different websites that allow you to just organize. And if you get 30 people RSVPing for a certain, you know, saying that they'll be at a certain film, then they get permission to host it there. So they've been doing screenings like that and traveling around and talking to people all about the information behind the film. So whether or not, whatever way you feel about it, it's a controversial topic. Councilmember Jack Christie was there and was present at the screening, and he said some very positive things at the end of it. And I think I still have footage of that. I interviewed him and afterwards and asked him, you know, what his thoughts were. And that can be found
on the
Houston Freethinkers YouTube channel. So, yeah, I mean, I could pull it up if you guys would like to play that, if we should play that. Because I think that is important to hear what, you know, somebody, a council member of our city out here in Houston, what they had to say. And Jack Christie tends to be, in the times that we've met him, like, I don't agree with him on, you know, everything, of course. But when it came to fighting water fluoridation or any sort of, like, health type thing, he's generally more open-minded and interested in listening and working together than we've ever seen with any other sort of council members. So this is, I'll play that interview real quick, and then in a couple minutes we're going to be hearing from Oscar to discuss the local fight against the Dakota Access Pipeline and launch of a new group here in Houston called Houston Stands with Standing Rock. So check this interview out.
In Texas, and I'm talking with an old friend of mine, a fighter for health freedom here in Houston, Councilmember Jack Christie. How are you doing?
I'm doing great today.
So we just watched the documentary Vax. This is the first time I've seen it. Is this your first time watching it?
Yes. I knew some of the statistics. I read Dr. Wakefield's book and such, but this just fortified because it had the top scientists, it had people inside the CDC, it had parents. It just gut-wrenching stories. So the movie puts it all together. Everybody in America should read that.
Absolutely. I would say the same thing. It's very powerful, well put together. What do you say to the critics, though, who look at Dr. Wakefield and say, look at Dr. Wakefield's work and say that, you know, he was discredited by the medical establishment, and so because of that, people shouldn't pay attention to this documentary?
Listen, the medical-industrial complex criticizes anybody that doubts their pill, shot, surgery mentality. And there's money in the game of the medical industrial complex. It's about money now. It's not about your health. It's not about my health. It's protecting their false science. I mean, you are born with natural immunity to all these diseases. Breastfeeding mothers hands that to the child. Mother Nature and the father of Mother Nature gives that to children. You don't need artificial vaccinations that have side effects to bolster that. You know, really, you may be a weaker defense system than the one with natural immunity. So in the normal childhood diseases, when you're exposed to it, you have natural immunity the rest of your life. So medicine doesn't believe that.
So, you know, at the end of the documentary, they talked about four steps that they want the listeners and the viewers to take, trying to get their council, their Congress members to support subpoenaing the CDC scientists and a host of other options. What can you do as a council member here in Houston on the local level, on the city level, do to help out, you know, the family members and such people of Houston who are concerned with this? How can we do something on a local level?
Actually, I've been doing it in elected office. From the 40,000 local school board children, State Board of Education all through the 90s, and then the past 5 years on city council. Quit drugging these kids and quit spraying the campuses with poisons for insects, weeds, and pests. They're poison. They get in the system, fry the nervous system. These are foreign chemicals. They're neurotoxins, means they're toxic to the nervous system. And so I've been doing that fight. Sometimes I'm laughed at. Sometimes I'm scoffed at. Not as bad as Dr. Wakefield. But the CDC caught a quote of mine at Houston City Council. And I said, you can prevent the flu. You don't need an artificial shot that rarely works. Sometimes it can give you the flu, contrary to what they hand to the TV broadcasters. And I said, you can prevent the flu. He said, if you eat right, proper rest, exercise, you know, you have a good immune system if it's a tuned-up nervous system. A week later, a CDC spokesman says, Dr. Christie can exercise, sleep, you know, eat right, he's still going to get the flu. That person has no idea of physiology, immunology, because every regular exercise person knows they are healthier than everybody else. They eat right, you know, and they just don't get disease. So, you know, CDC, it's about money over there.
It's very difficult to be, you know, somebody concerned with health in the United States and to trust the medical establishments. You know, when we have things like water fluoridation, we've got unsafe vaccines and this, you know, a host of other things that have been approved by the health agencies, including the CDC in this country. What do you have any particular message that you would like to offer just to leave the people of Houston with?
Well, first of all, the CDC has to do long-term studies, not we got this vaccine. In the Ford administration, swine flu is coming. It's going to kill everybody. Oh, well, we happen to have a vaccine. Okay, everybody, mandatory. You got to get it. Swine flu never came. They killed 27 people, injured thousands, and $1 billion of lawsuit against the U.S. government for a failed vaccine. And so long-term study is one thing. You know, and I agree with all the recommendations from Vax, except that last one. He says separating the vaccines, that'd be less damaging. But if you got a little bit of poison, it's still bad for you. So I just think that we're given a body that has natural immunity. If you don't interfere with the pregnancy and drugs during pregnancy, it is built to fight these diseases. Artificial immunity may do more damage than good. So I just think, why separate three poisons into a group into three when it's still toxic to the body?
So thank you for your time, Councilman.
You're quite welcome.
Appreciate it.
Be healthy.
Thank you.
That was Councilmember Jack Christie at the Houston premiere of Vaxxed, or one of the last premieres. They had a few screenings here in the city, and that was last Tuesday, I believe. And yeah, so you heard what he had to say. You can find that video on youtube.com/HoustonFreethinkers if you want to watch it again and share it with your friends and family. I know it's a controversial topic, and we can feel free to talk about that later. But now we've got our guest on the line. Oscar, are you with us?
I'm here.
Hey, brother. Thank you for coming on to the show.
Thanks for having me.
So I briefly mentioned, you know, what we've been dealing with the past couple weeks. Last show we talked about, we were going to have you on, and it didn't work out last week, but we talked about the trip to North Dakota, to the reservation, and everything that we experienced there, and the idea of bringing the fight back to Houston. And then this past Friday, we had the action that went very well, and, you know, we had a good amount of people attend, and there were no issues, and everyone was allowed to express themselves. And definitely the people there, Energy Transfer Partners, knew that, you know, the people of Houston were unhappy and were out there voicing their opinions. And then this Saturday, things got a little bit crazy out at near the reservation at the site of the construction. And since then, things have kind of stepped up. And also Saturday was sort of the official beginning of the global weeks of solidarity that the Red Warrior Camp called for people around the country to do direct action and protests and rallies and prayers at the banks who are funding the pipeline and at the companies who have who are the stakeholders in the pipeline. So, you know, this is, we're seeing action and protests happen in lots of different places, but there was an action this morning that you helped put together that was specifically a response to the violence that took place this weekend. So go ahead and tell everybody a little bit about what happened this weekend and then why you wanted to put together the action this morning.
Well, this weekend, Saturday at 3 p.m., dogs were released on peaceful protesters, and they were also maced there at Standing Rock. And the media reported lies about the protesters being violent, and they just twisted many things around. And Friday, at our successful movement here in Houston, we had a member of KHOU come on out, and they took some of our story, but they never reported it. And on Sunday, they decided that they would regurgitate lies of what was going on in Standing Rock. So we did target KHOU this morning. We demanded that they tell the truth. We demanded that they would hear us and they would speak to us. And so we stood out front of their studios on Allen Parkway with our drums and with our songs. And we drummed for 2 hours and we chanted for 2 hours. And they sent a representative out to do some interviews with us. And so we feel that today was a victory. We feel that we were heard. And now we're just waiting for that message to be shared. We let them know if they didn't share our message, we'd be back.
That's awesome. And I'm looking at, I just saw somebody posted a picture of a tweet from KHOU Channel 11 News Houston. And it says, we covered it all weekend. The protest on Allen Parkway will run in our 5 p.m. newscast.
All right.
So it looks like you said, it was a success, and I definitely appreciate you being out there. And we definitely have rallied in the past. There have been, you know, national march against the quote unquote mainstream media because of these same reasons. You know, like you were saying, and I did some, you know, investigating myself, and most of the local reporting in the North Dakota area near Cannonball, where this is taking place, was immediately, you know, painting the protesters as the aggressors, and the police as being, or not the police, but the security officers as being the victim. And I personally feel like that's to make sure that the locals don't support it, you know, that they can, you know, that they don't start to side. Not that there isn't local support, but that the locals get this perception of like, oh, the protesters are being the violent ones. Mm-hmm. And just in general, the media. And then you saw a lot of the national media pick that up. Thankfully, there was video, really good video from Democracy Now! And Amy Goodman, where she was there and got the whole thing on camera and asking the security officers that are sitting there literally holding pepper spray cans in their hands, like, hey, what did you just spray on those people? And he's like, I didn't spray anything on anyone. She's like, well, what is that in your hand? He's like, I don't have anything. And just like, they're just being silly, you know, and sicking the dogs on people and just indiscriminately spraying. And, you know, I think I've seen some people make the argument, well, this land that, you know, since it's not directly on the reservation land, the energy transfer partners, they, through eminent domain, they got the land from somebody, whoever owned it before, and that person's been paid, so technically, legally, that is private property owned by energy transfer partners. So the Red Warrior Camp and the supporters were violating or invading the private property, and the security officers were just responding in kind. And I think that, to me, I think that view is short-sighted in the sense that there are, you know, important... there are grave sites, there are important historical areas that not only to the tribes but to history itself that are being dug up for the construction of this pipeline. And also, I would say, maybe on a deeper sense and maybe a spiritual sense, if you will, that these people, and I definitely, you know, feel really included in this, are not just fighting against oil itself, but also what they feel is kind of a much larger issue of protecting and defending the waters and the earth itself. That comes from these traditions, and that's why we're seeing over now since the last week's show, when it was 65, now it's over 125 tribal nations together. So I don't know, I just think, I really, the more I think about it, I really think we're dealing with sort of a clash of views of the world, you know, and sort of outlooks just in general, like world views that are very diametrically opposed.
Well, yeah, very much so.
So you're going to be on channel 11. For those who are here local or those who are, you know, listening from afar, you can find it, KHOU 11 Houston. I'm sure they'll put it online as well. And anybody want to catch that online, do so, because that's definitely a good victory. And I mentioned earlier that we'd started a group now, a page that people can follow, Houston yes. Stands with Standing Rock. What are the next plans, or has there been any plans discussed yet, Oscar? Or are there more organizational meetings or anything that you have in mind yet?
We're looking at having a meeting this Wednesday at Midtown Bar and Grill at 7:30. We need to come together and plan and talk a little bit more. We need to discuss our unified vision as supporters of Standing Rock and to move forward. Something that I know that the quote-unquote enemies will count on is that we lose momentum, and that's something that we will not do. This is not a one-time standing in front of 1300 Main. This is not a one-time standing in front of the media. We will stand and we'll march as long as our brothers and sisters are out at the front lines. That's a dedication that we have, and it's not going anywhere.
Yeah, well, thank you, Oscar. I appreciate that. Thank you. I appreciate the message. And we've talked about this as well. We're talking through the Freethinkers and through a couple other local art organizations. I'm supposed to meet as well with someone on Wednesday. We're trying to get a venue together so that we can host a benefit to raise awareness and get some winter clothing together, some blankets and such for the Standing Rock Reservation and those who are there at the Sacred Stone Spirit Camp and the Red Warrior Camp, and plan another road trip back there. And I know that there are some other people that are already involved in this effort who are planning to go back next week. And people are coming from all around the country to really support. And that's why I say that I'm not sure people quite yet understand how big of a fight this is and how historical it is and how it's not just going to go away. That I don't think, you know, and the thing is that there's supposed to be a decision this Friday by the judge in the district court in D.C. who's going to decide whether or not the Army Corps of Engineers, you know, properly consulted with the tribal nations in the area, specifically the Standing Rock Sioux. So we'll see how things go throughout the week. But as I said earlier, this is also sort of, they called from the 3rd to the 17th for as much action, you know, related to the pipeline in different places. And I think also approaching the complicit media and the media who's not really doing a good job of covering it or is being biased, et cetera, when there's obvious, you know, they're saying all these things about knives being pulled out. And then, like, you know, usual, the power of the internet, you can see social media videos of people who are there. Yep. And seeing the exact opposite. So it shows you the power that the people really do have, and that, again, how a powerful tool the internet can be. Well, I thank you for your time, Brother Oscar, and I can tell you're losing your voice because you've been screaming the past weekend.
Yes.
All right. Well, thank you for all the work that you do. I know everybody out there appreciates it, and you've been getting out there doing some really beautiful things. Again, everybody, if you want to see what happened on Friday, check out youtube.com/Houston Freethinkers. You'll see that video of Friday's action. And also, if you want to look at Channel 11 after our show ends, they said it for somewhere at 5 o'clock, they'll be putting on the report from outside of their building today when Oscar and Houston Stands with Standing Rock went out there and made some noise and made them cover this issue. So thank you for your work, Oscar.
Absolutely. Anytime. Thank you for all y'all do.
All right, we'll talk to you soon.
All right, stay blessed. Bye-bye.
That's awesome. I'm glad to hear more about it. And you're right, you know, you don't hear about it in the media. And this is one of the examples where the alternative press has really been, for the most part, the only ones delivering, you know, any facts about this. So I think you're like the people who are, you know, beginning to get the word out about this. You know, you said something about how, you know, having a benefit in order to raise awareness. I think it's at that type of, it's that type of issue that you really have to raise awareness about it. And, you know, I appreciate Oscar getting out there and talking to people, because, you know, we all have our different viewpoints to begin with. But as you look into these issues, you know, you become so much more educated about the process that brought it to some, to its particular point, you know. And it's in that you have your critique, and then, you know, you also have your maybe your path forward is figuring out, you know, where things went wrong or whatever. But I wanted to ask you. You said it was originally eminent domain, or like, doesn't the pipeline just have the eminent domain unless it's already an established?
Well, there's a number of reasons that it's being fought. And the Iowa farmers, they're like, because it's also going from like Indiana through Iowa and then up to North Dakota, so it's cutting across multiple places. But in Iowa, that's where the farmers are fighting over eminent domain claims. But the Standing Rock Sioux, their reservation is about half a mile from that, and it's actually on, you know, where they've been camping on. So there's two sides of it. On one side of the Cannonball River is actually their reservation land. Then across the river is technically U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, and that's where the most of the people are, and that's called the Red Warrior Camp. Then a little bit further from that is where the actual construction is being dug, and that's about a half mile from their reservation. So it's not technically on reservation land. And what I was saying is, whoever owned that part, that land that they're using right now, obviously they sold it to Energy Transfer Partners, you know, because that's now the company's land, and they're choosing to dig it up and create this well. But the reasons the tribe is fighting it, other than, you know, environmental and them believing that it's a much bigger fight to stop an unsustainable practice and try to get people to stop, you know, using the oil and being invasive to the earth and things like that. But also that there are several different grave sites along the path, and some of them have already been dug up, and even in the past couple of days. So a number of tribes that have been coming out there, they're coming there because there's been battles and different graves that have been put along the path that it's supposed to take. And so overall, they say they're suing the Army Corps of Engineers, saying that they were not properly consulted before, you know, before construction began earlier this month, or yeah, early in August, actually. Now we're in September. But yeah, so it's been going on for, yeah, a few weeks now, almost a month, and the camp continues to grow. And like I said, the tribes continue to unite around this issue and a number of other issues. I think it's just going to continue to grow. It's very interesting to see. And this weekend, as Oscar was discussing, you know, there was just the level of violence is starting to escalate out there. And so hopefully things can go a different direction. We're going to go to a quick song, though, from the Cake Rangers. Tell the people about the Cake Rangers, Micah.
Oh, I think the musical stands for itself. We'll just hear. Right. Makes me want cake, though, I'll tell you that much.
That does make me want cake.
Hey, they're going to be on a Herman show this Thursday, and they'll tell you all about themselves and their project and such. So check out Sweet Nightmares, another KPFT show here on Thursday nights.
Sweet. All right, this is Summerton Men from Cake Rangers, and I can already see on the line we have our next guest, Adam Kokesh. So we're going to play this song, and we'll be right back with Adam Kokesh to talk about his For the Love of Freedom tour. He'll be in Houston Thursday night. Stay tuned. You're listening to Freethinker Radio on 90.1 KPFT Houston. Welcome back to Freethinker Radio on 90.1 KPFT Houston. My name is Derrick Broze, and I'm here with Micah Jackson. That was the Cake Rangers.
That they were. And you can hear them Thursday Rangers. On Herman's show if you want to get more into that.
Rangers so, of Cake.
Cake. We like cake. What can I say? We have our guest, right?
Yep, and we have our guest now. We just spoke a couple minutes ago with Oscar. Thank you, Oscar, for calling in. Now we got our next guest here to talk about his tour across the country, spreading the good word, and he'll be speaking in Houston Thursday night. Welcome to the show, Adam Kokesh.
Hey, thanks for having me on.
Yeah, man, thanks for being here with us. I'm here with Micah.
Definitely welcome, Adam. How are you?
Excellent. Been a bit of an interesting day today. We're dealing with our first major technical difficulties of the tour. We had a wheel bearing blowout on the Freedomobile trailer. So I'm driving right now from Austin to San Antonio, watching the trailer very carefully out of the side view mirror to make sure this wheel doesn't start to get wobbly or fall off. And hopefully we make it to the service shop where we can get helped out in time. But it's been, you know, we're just a week into this now, and it has been so awesome. You know, a lot of us who do a lot of our work as activists on the internet see a lot of trolls on a daily basis, and to get out and meet people in real life and feel the love and the connectedness and the passion that people have for the message of freedom and for this movement and for supporting me and my work and what I'm doing, it's incredible to feel it when you get out.
Awesome, man. I'm glad it's been going well. How long have you been on the road now?
Just a week. But technically, I've been living out of an RV trailer for 2 years as of next month, and I've been on the road for most of that time. It was only just relatively recently that I've been living in the trailer on my land in order to build a house.
Nice. And yes, I've been able to visit the land, the Freedom Ranch out there, definitely. Well, before we get into talking about Freedom Ranch, though, tell everybody here in our audience, we've got a lot of lots of variation in our audience. So there may be some people who are new to your work and your ideas. So go ahead and tell everybody a little bit about your book and also, you know, what you are looking to accomplish with this tour.
Sure. Well, my background is from the military, coming out in activism with Iraq Veterans Against the War, realizing it's not enough to be against a war or militarism, but it has to be statism itself is the main objective in overcoming to achieve a free society. And so I got involved with a lot of civil disobedience through that. And it was while I was in jail in D.C. that I started writing Freedom in order to be the easiest way to share this message with other people. People were sending me all the greatest books, you know, all the great manifestos, and I just figured I'd be the greatest ripoff artist in the freedom movement and take all of their best elements and none of their worst. And what we got with a lot of help was a 100-page book that is the fastest way to take someone from zero to I get it and to share the message with someone else. So it's free. My book is free in every digital format possible at thefreedomline.com. You can order paper copies there as well. And we're giving away copies on this tour at every event we are doing. It seems now 64 events. We got one or two we got to confirm, but it looks like 64 events in 63 days. This is the second time I've done a complete national book tour like this. I've done a few national tours as an activist before, and I love being on the road. You know, I love connecting with people like this, and I love feeling love from people who are on board with this message. But one of the things that I do at most of our stops is I put our audience on the spot. I say, how many of you can say that you've shared this message with your family, with, you know, people that you're in regular immediate contact with? And it varies a lot, but for some groups you get most fans, for some you just get a few, and that's where we really need to get our game on as a freedom movement, is be better evangelicals of this message and be better at sharing it by being positive and patient and sharing something out of love and compassion that is valuable to us and will be valuable to other people when they get to embrace freedom as well.
For sure, well said.
So how would you summarize the content of your book?
The content of Freedom is how we move past the status paradigm to achieve a free society, and provide the full analysis of how a non-coercive society will be happier and more harmonious and more prosperous than a statist, centrally planned, or controlled society. So it starts with the philosophy That's chapter one. It goes into a history of statism, how we got to this point. It's a very important perspective that I think a lot of people who do genuinely wake up to the core philosophical message are missing. Then it gets into war, personal security and justice services, that sort of thing. The economics are covered in there, other government rackets. So it really does answer as many, but what about this type of questions? You know, who will build the roads? And by the way, I can say I've built a road. I've got that under my belt now. Built a road connecting my land to the existing roads. The book also has what I think is a really important piece of this message that, again, is missing from a lot of people's way that they talk about this or their worldview. And it's the idea of personal freedom. That if freedom really is about respecting your will externally in between yourself and fellow human beings, that doing it internally and escaping the emotional manipulation that is essential to statism and the fear-based propaganda. So yes, the book also contains The Secret of Happiness. That's kind of nice, you know, nice little bonus, chapter 9. And then chapter 10, The Future of Freedom, which is about how we move forward and how really the achievement of a free society, of course, barring the anomalies of nuclear war or a meteor striking the earth and wiping us all out or a pandemic or something like that, that the achievement of a voluntary society is inevitable. It is the destiny of humanity. It is the natural course of progress of life itself to achieve that state of greater harmony. And I think it's really important to give people that, rather than a sense of fear or hopelessness, but a sense that we are moving forward, that this is something that there's no obligation, there's no commitment, there's no bullying to get you involved in this. But, you know, holy crap, we are living in the most interesting times in human history, and we have an incredible opportunity to move humanity forward right now.
Awesome. Definitely, I recommend checking out the book. It's not a huge book and a pretty easy, simple read. Gets the idea across very simply to those who are new to the ideas and for those who I think are into the concepts and been studying them and pursuing them for some time. You put it in a really succinct way. So
yeah, I appreciate that. It's just 100 pages. It's a free 3-hour audiobook. And for a lot of people who think they got the core of the message philosophically, that's great. I'd like to offer you this as a way to round out your understanding and to be a better communicator of the message. And then for people who are new, to be able to give them that entire complete picture as efficiently and as positively, as easily as possible. That's the kind of thing we should be looking at with sharing this message.
Awesome. How do you feel like you mentioned, we're living in interesting times. How do you feel like the message of freedom is doing these days when, the two big political parties are choosing between, Clinton and Trump, these two things, and also, as you've recently noted on your YouTube channel, that third party wise, Libertarian Party is running Gary Johnson, who's not even a Libertarian, and doesn't have, and neither him or his VP pick have, they really don't have very many Libertarian positions, and they support things like the TPP and just, gun control and other things that you're just like, what the heck is going on? And then the other option is Jill Stein, despite her good intentions, really wants to use the state to grow the state in a way.
Right.
So, I mean, how do you feel overall, though? I mean, obviously that's the political world and freedom is bigger than just that, but how do you feel like we're doing these days?
Well, one of the things, let me step back to answer that first. I have been around as a full-time activist for 10 years now, and I've seen a lot of people in the movement come and go, but I've also seen that there's a convergence happening. People wake up, they don't go back to sleep. And it's not a great metaphor, but once you understand the true nature of government, you realize that it's obsolete, you're inspired for humanity that we can do better, you don't forget those things. They don't go away. So waking up, this is a natural course of human progress that more people get this message. And one of the things that I've seen, and like I'm glad you said this is the political world, because I was at the 2016 Libertarian Party National Convention, and what I saw is that there were a lot of young, enthusiastic people who went up against the establishment and lost and decided to say, screw voting. Voting is unethical. And I don't want anything to do with the party. I'm getting out of here. I don't want to have anything to do with the Gary Johnson types. And if you look at the political world, you see that, Gary Johnson got just barely the nomination, not even on the first ballot. And a lot of those younger people came in and left and came in and left and came in and left. And that's what happens, I think, every election cycle for people getting involved in the political side. And we get the impression that the movement, they're just playing Gary Johnson's people as there are true libertarians, and it's absolutely not true. And I'm hoping part of what I intend to do, if not just by growing my base and my sector of the movement, as you may have heard, I am running for not president in 2020. It's, as long as the support continues to build, we're in exploratory mode right now. So what that means is I'm running for president on the platform of the immediate dissolution of the entire federal government. I can say I'm running for not president because the only thing I'm going to go in and do is sign one executive order to begin the administrative process of dissolving the federal government, transitioning it back to the states in every way that is necessary, and simply abolishing and sending people home where it's not. I think if we apply libertarian principles in a consistent way, they should immediately be beneficial for everyone. We say what we want to do is we want to eliminate government, but we want to do it in a way that doesn't pull the rug out from underneath anyone. We want an evolution. We don't want a revolution. We want to do it responsibly. Then we can really bring people together of a whole different host of political persuasions around this. But what I think is most important is bringing people who really care about freedom, philosophical libertarians, giving them a way to engage with people around them. That's the point of my book. I hope that's been the point of my YouTube channel and my podcast in the past. I think I'm getting better every day in my activism by analyzing things based on what actually moves us forward, what wakes people up, what increases freedom, what is the most fun in our activism that keeps people engaged and coming back and feeling like they're productive and they're sharing something that's beautiful with people around them. So I'm really excited about this. This is part of the tour right now. We're recruiting volunteers for Kokesh 2020, and so far it's been an amazing experience. We're going to be announcing formally next summer, and it seems like if things continue to build as they have been, we're going to be doing so from a very strong position.
Awesome, man. Thank you. I really appreciate that explanation, and I know the audience does as well. So you're on the tour, and you're coming to Houston. Let's get into that. Let's talk about what's happening Thursday night.
Well, I'm just excited I get to hang out with Derrick Broze.
Oh, I don't know about that, man. I don't know about that. I think I'm going to try to come out and talk, though. I'm definitely going to try to come support your message. And I got to see Adam recently at the Jackalope Freedom Festival. We've talked about that. And that I think, was the beginning of your tour, correct?
No. The beginning was in Phoenix a couple weeks after that. I had to go back and prepare everything. But Jackalope was definitely a lot of fun, man. I wish we had more time there.
Yeah, definitely. I didn't get to stay the whole weekend, but another good place, another good gathering of people, and I guess that's what you have going on Thursday. I know that from what I've been seeing at the stops, I saw you were just in Austin and you were in Dallas and hanging out with all the activists there, and it seems like what I think I like the most about what it looks like you've been doing on the road is really trying to reach out to the local community and asking the activists who are in the community,
yes,
to come out and to speak and share what they have going on and discuss their ideas and making time for that. I think that's equally as important as
absolutely. And I want to make it clear that the way we're organizing this campaign and building an organization is intended not just to give me this one particular shot and this one particular mechanism, but to really help build the movement. So at every tour stop, we've invited local candidates, party reps, especially activists who are doing things outside of politics even, to come up and speak and make sure that we, I tell people, we're not going to do the turn to the person to your left and shake hands and turn to the person to your right and shake hands, but take advantage of this as an opportunity to get to meet people and connect with people in your community, to strengthen the movement, to strengthen each other as activists, and to plug in to the kind of organization that help people collaborate and bring their efforts together to be more effective. So I want to make sure that, when we talk about the mission of my campaign, it's not to win me votes. It's not to get to this point by tricking people into voting libertarian. It really is. If people ask, are you running an educational campaign or are you running to win? And the answer is yes. We want to educate enough people about the nature of government so that we shift the paradigm, so that we win after having woken up a critical mass of the American people and developed a consensus that moving forward through localization, eliminating the federal government is the first step, is how we move forward. I could be wrong about it happening this way. It could happen by a widespread secession movement. It could happen by government collapse. But I know that what I'm doing is the most effective way for me to connect with people outside of the movement, to win more converts to this message, and to make sure that however this transition happens, it's as peaceful and orderly as possible. And when you look at the other possibilities, what we're offering is really, you know, we can do things the easy way, for real. Like, it doesn't have to be ugly, it doesn't have to be bloody, it doesn't even have to be contentious. We can win people over with love, with positivity, being patient, and sharing the message in a way that empowers them until we reach that critical mass. And regardless of what happens with my campaign, I hope that the legacy of it can be a contribution to humanity that is, you know, based on waking people up and spreading this message.
Awesome, man. Thank you for really breaking that down. That sounds like it's going to be an epic tour. Every time you do come to town, it's always fun, and people get to hang out with you, hear your ideas, sign the trailer. I think, are you getting another trailer?
Well, the trailer might not make it to Houston. We're going to find out here in about half an hour when we get to the service shop, see what's going on. But yeah, it's been, like I said, I've been living in the trailer for 2 years, and every stop we invite people to come sign it and join me on the journey that way.
Awesome, yeah. And so you're going to be speaking 7 p.m.?
7 p.m. Well, you're going to be on at 7. We're starting with our guest speakers at 7 usually, and then I go on about 7:30. But I'm kind of MC the whole thing, and I really like being able to do that as well. It's such a fun way to connect with people and to be able to present other speakers myself.
Awesome, that sounds great. It's going to be at the Midtown Bar and Grill?
Do you say so?
All right, well, then that's where it's
going to be. Right.
All right, yep, that's what I thought it was going to be at. Cool. Well, that's off West Gray. For everyone who's not familiar, check it out. You can find that place on Facebook, Midtown Bar and Grill. We've hosted lots of events there upstairs, and you'll get to hear Adam Kokesh. And you're going to have the books there?
Of course, free books for everyone. Whether or not we got the trailer, we will have free books for everyone.
Awesome, great. All right, brother. Well, anything else you want to let them know
about
tonight?
Is this Thursday?
Thursday night, yeah.
Yeah, right after this is D-Trey Val's finale for the Make a Noise showcase. So there'll be a lot of talent coming through right after, I guess, around 9 o'clock or so.
Okay, cool. So there's a show in the same venue following Adam's event. So if you want to come hang out, hear Adam, hear all about this, and then hang out, stay afterwards and hear some music, sounds like that would be a nice night. So you got that to look forward to. Anything you want to leave us with, Adam?
Peace, love, and freedom. Books are free. TheFreedomLine.com. If you're anywhere else in the country and you want to see us on the road, TheFreedomLine.com, TheFreedomLine.com. Click on calendar. You can see all our upcoming dates. And I'm having a civil disobedience build party at my place in Arizona. If you want to come out to that, check it out. The event's on Facebook, November 4th to 13th.
Awesome. Thank you. Check that out at TheFreedomLine.com, and you can find Adam on Facebook, of course. Thank you for your time, brother.
Thank you.
Enjoy your day. All right.
It's always fun to talk to Adam.
Yeah, Adam Kokesh right there. Like we said, he's on tour right now, speaking different cities every couple nights or so. He'll be in Houston Thursday night, and you can find that on Facebook. And, of course, if you're following along, we're about to catch up and post all the information. I've got some articles to post that we just on the Dakota Access Pipeline and some of the things we just discussed. I'm going to post those in the stream because I haven't been doing that the past couple minutes. We're going to jump to a quick song and come back because we got musical guests.
Yeah, we got all kinds of stuff to get
and
into.
And news
today.
And stuff. I'm going to give us a second to catch up on posting these links. If you want to follow along, go to Freethinker Radio on Facebook page, on the Facebook page, and you'll see our event. And you'll also see you've got a little bit more time to share the flyer for the Houston Open Air Festival from Freethinker Radio. You've got about 10 minutes or so until 4 o'clock.
Bit, a little bit longer.
So if you're listening now, start sharing again. Share it on your Facebook page again. Tell your friends to check out this festival. Share it in a couple of groups. Share it on some friend that won't mind if you share it on their page.
Maybe they need to know.
Maybe they need to know because you're about to win free tickets, maybe. And there's a lot of cool bands. And you get to listen to us talk.
And if you don't win,
there'll be
another chance to win a pair of tickets.
Every Monday this
that.
Month. Yeah. So there's going to be different opportunities. But we're going to jump to a song from Erebus. This is some heavy stuff. So enjoy it. Maybe if you have sensitive ears, turn the volume down right about now.
Or just get out of the room.
Or leave the room. I don't know. But we'll be back in just a couple minutes. You're listening to Freethinker Radio on 90.1 KPFT Houston. Welcome back to Freethinker Radio on 90.1 KPFT Houston. That was Erebus Without Sanctuary. They are, of course, from here in Houston, and you can find them on Facebook And on YouTube and all that good stuff. And they will be playing, just a little sneak peek, they'll be playing for the Community 12, which is, of course, a production of the Houston Freethinkers and Visionary Noise, which of
November 12th.
Micah and I are a part of. So November 12th, we're putting this together. We announced 8 of the bands last week. We're going to be announcing some more tonight or tomorrow, you know, sometime this week for sure. We're releasing more names, and there's going to be about 45 to 50 acts on November 12th at For the Community for free for your enjoyment. Plus art, plus local vendors and all sorts of things. So
merchants, speakers, poets.
People speaking important topics. And you get to hear Erebus among plenty of other bands and artists that we are going to
new friends, old friends.
And in a few minutes, we're going to be having an interview with Rhymes with Orange. But right now, let's get into some local news, huh?
Yeah, sounds good. Let's get into something. You want to go ahead?
You go for it.
Okay,
go
I got some
it.
Stuff here. All right. You know, this is... We got a few things here we've been covering for a minute. But let's see. There's... Turns out that the judges have been sued as part of the Harris County Federal Court bail challenge. We've talked about that here, how people are challenging the constitutionality of Harris County's pretrial bail policy, saying, you know, it's an unusual punishment for the poor to spend like a week in jail and lose a job and such over a ticket or something like that. And we've been talking about that over, I guess, about a month now. But yeah, it's turned out that the lawsuit initially targeted county sheriff as well as hearing officers who use strict bail bond schedule to set bail for misdemeanor offenders whose cases they review via video hearings. You can get into this article and more. So I just want to let you know that, yeah, it's moved on into a lawsuit now, and this is something we'll continue to hear about. So we'll see if there's any remedy. And I should have probably gone through some details that we've given you before about the cases. One of them, if you remember, was Miranda O'Donnell, that 22-year-old single mother who was jailed last year after being arrested for driving without a license only because she could not afford to post bail. That's one of many where someone with a misdemeanor who lacks funds ends up having their life a lot more messed up than someone who has funds. And we got a lot more going on in Houston. And one of these cases here, this one story, it kind of has two parts, like two different stories within one. I didn't even know we had an oversight panel in Houston. Did you know that?
I didn't know that either.
Yeah, you know, this... Oh, okay, we're getting our call. So I think we're going to go ahead and take this. This should be Gene with Rhymes with Orange. We're going to play some of their music. Should we just go ahead? Okay, we lost that call. Gene, if that was you, call back. All right. So, yes. And hey, we love being on KPFT. If you haven't already liked that page, please do, because we are one of many shows here on the HD as well as over on the FM channels. So we mentioned Herman's show earlier, Sweet Nightmares. We often mention Lisa's show on Saturday night. Night Sounds gets into all kinds of local music and regional music. So we're going to talk to, speaking of music, we're going to speak to Gene right now from Rhymes with Orange. How are you, Gene?
I'm doing well.
Awesome. Well, I'm glad to talk to you. I'm sure a lot of our listeners don't know much about you yet, and we're going to play a track of yours or a couple here in a little bit. But I wondered if you could just tell us a little bit about yourself and how you met your friend and y'all decided to make Rhymes with Orange and get out there and share the music with the world. So tell us a little bit about who you are.
Sure. We're a 2-piece punk / grunge band. We actually met, which is kind of a funny story, actually. My buddy Jacob, who's the guitarist of the band, he had an ad up on Craigslist wanting a drummer. I replied to that. However, he didn't really think I was right for the job. So fast forward months later, I put up an ad on Craigslist wanting to be a drummer for a band, and he contacted me. It was kind of funny because he sent me the link to his Craigslist, and it was an ad that I already answered to, but he said I wasn't fit for.
That is pretty funny.
So when we met up, you know, when I saw his link, you know, I didn't want to tell him that I was the drummer that already applied, but
yeah, the one you already rejected.
After we jammed out, but it was awesome when we jammed out the very first time. It was like lightning in a bottle.
Nice.
Yeah, we synced up pretty well, and we wrote about 3 songs that day alone. Yep. that was in March, so, yeah.
So y'all are a relatively new band. Have y'all played out very much?
Yes, sir. We've played at very few venues. We played at the White Swan, Super Happy Funland, and this Friday we're playing at Dan's Electros, which should be fun.
Nice, nice. So y'all are getting out there, cutting your teeth. What have you? What have been some of the most interesting things that you've experienced in the time that you've been a band and just doing shows? What's really kind of stuck with you? Whether it was fun or just something you learned, or you know,
just learning how everything, is really. You know, like we go out here and try to get these shows, learning how everything is, how everything works, how the business works, how getting shows works, and the more and more we play, we meet new people, and we get to experience other bands from all over, and hearing their stories and you know where they've come from. So
I think you're right. You know, do something and things happen. You know, you get out there and you start finding the next steps. You know, you got to go as far as you can to see, and then you know, see farther, you know. That's interesting. I see y'all are from Humble. Are there many places that you can play there?
No, sir. There really isn't much places in Humble for us to play. We mainly go into Houston to play.
This is informative for me, so I'm kind of enjoying this. You know, this is like I'm getting to see into a whole different community.
Yeah, I mean, there's places like the White Swan and Happy Funland that that will take us regardless of whatever. But for a starting out punk band, it is actually pretty hard to find shows and stuff like that. You know, like bigger venues, they don't have any interest in us because, we're a punk band and they just,
Yeah, I'm sometimes frustrated as someone who does book shows when a venue tells me, we can't have this or that type of music. And I've had it happen more than a few times. It's kind of unnerving because I've seen a variety of music at some of these venues sometimes, nonetheless, I think you hit on a point, though. You know, get out there, play what shows you can, meet new friends, go to new venues and such. Where does any popular music play in Humble? Is there such a place? Like, maybe y'all don't play there, but maybe
Scout Bar would be one of them for sure. And we were told the White Swan venue was a pretty big venue. We've played there like 4 times now, and really hasn't been too big of a crowd, but it is what it is, kind of a thing. You know, it's just a bar. But,
yeah.
As far as we know right now, the Scout Bar in Houston is...
That's where y'all want to be. That's that.
Oh, yeah. That's a very big venue, so...
Nice. Yeah, it's fun. It's clean. It's nice to get out there. We're definitely interested in hearing your music come Friday, I believe it is, right? The September 9th at Dan Electro's that you were speaking of that. We also... you've got SoundCloud out there, and I was going to ask you... which song, because I haven't gone through them all, but which song should we play on, which song is radio friendly?
I would say Destination Unknown and Mean Hammer actually are our two
most
radio friendly songs that we have on the EP we just released about a month ago.
Nice. Are you going to have physical copies of the EP at the show?
Yes, sir.
All right. Let's see. We're going to get into that in just a minute, but I wanted to just kind of wrap things up with y'all now. So everybody can come out and see you in the Heights on East 24th Street at Dan Electro's on the 9th, come up Friday, along with 4 other acts. I want to just ask you what you want to leave the audience with.
I'd say come out and see us. We are a grunge / punk band. You know, not a lot of grunge bands are out, nowadays. So it'd be interesting.
It sounds good. Y'all are a 2-piece, so that'll bring a very unique energy. And being a 2-piece punk band, I expect it to be intense. So I'll be there, and I hope a lot of our friends will be there, and look forward to seeing it. So we're going to get into your music now, and I'll talk to y'all Friday.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Right. Sounds good.
Thanks for calling in, guys.
All right.
Yep.
Cool. We'll be right back.
hesitate. Can you make the date? Now you're all alone. Now you're on your own, but you're still not grown. Destination unknown. All these measly fees to bring you to your knees. Destination unknown. And all be all, and they will watch you fall. Feeling out of luck, fill it out, mail it in, and you can't get in. Now you're all alone. Is this reality, or just make-believe? Destination unknown. Can I get to say what I want every day? Destination unknown.
Moving through a busy show today. I kind of didn't talk to those guys as long as I wanted. Maybe we'll bring them back next time. But we got, you know, we covered everything. That was an interesting song. We're going to get into some more music of theirs, but we definitely have a lot of news to cover as well. So do appreciate all our listeners. And we know that oftentimes we have new listeners that tune in to hear, you know, today's guests. So we often cover local news, and we try to avoid most of the political stuff sometimes, at least the names.
Yeah, we try not to say those whose names cannot be repeated.
One thing I've noticed is we've ran this show for, I guess, almost half a decade now in different formats. And lately, since we came over to KPFT, we've kind of been spending a lot more time on local news. And I think what I've noticed with doing this is some of the stuff that's going on that's mentioned, you know, in our local television, in the Chronicle, in the Houston Press, some of the stuff, you'd basically have to be ignoring the news not to know that some of this stuff goes on. And then I'm starting to wonder, you know, is it like this in each big city? You know, I think before we used to just hit the local and talk about a few things, you know, that were going on, events that were happening, et cetera, maybe a few big hot issues, and then move on into regional and then into national. Oftentimes we find ourselves barely able to get to the national news nowadays. So please remember that page. We often share articles there as well. And if you have any information, any news you think we should cover, feel free to message us as well. You know, I'm going to go ahead and get into that quick story, because I didn't even know we had a police oversight panel, you know. It turns out this one was from the Houston Chronicle, and I don't know how deep I want to get into it, because I don't exactly agree with everything in it, but there's some informative pieces. Turns out that this the writer believes that it needs more teeth, and he asks, how do city residents determine whether the police oversight board is effective at holding the police department accountable? Good question, right? Sometimes it takes a crisis before someone asks that question, and he or the writer urges us not to wait for that crisis. Our independent police oversight board, he informs us, has been in place since 2011.
Wow, I hadn't heard of that either.
Yeah, I was kind of shocked. Established by executive order under Mayor Anise Parker, its mission is, in part, to address community concerns. The objective is to provide a system of accountability and transparency to give residents a say into the internal investigative process of the Houston Police Department. The oversight board's creation was laudable, but the watchdog is long overdue for more bite. Despite the growing use of video cameras and claims of police abuse across the country, HPD still investigates itself, even in sensitive cases. And that is not a situation that engenders trust by Houston's diverse citizenry. Several enhancements to the board. Relevance should be considered to give it true and meaningful independent oversight. The oversight board was created and is composed of 21 unpaid volunteers appointed by the mayor and confirmed by city council. See how you get in there? It's the one for transparency, right? Yeah. As structured, the board is divided into four panels, all charged with review of internal policy investigations of excessive force allegations, discharge of firearms, and serious bodily injury or death. Other responsibilities include review and recommendations for recruitment, training, and evaluation of police officers, etc. Oversight board must be given clear, independent authority to investigate when necessary and recommend policy changes through the police department, mayor's office, and city council. As currently constituted, the board is a review body assigned to cases referred by HPD Internal Affairs. But to be effective, the board must have the ability to initiate its own investigations when appropriate. It should be granted the power to obtain information outside police approval and cooperation. Yeah, imagine that. A real oversight committee. Civilian volunteers alone cannot adequately perform investigations. That's the claim of this writer, at least. It would be prudent to allocate funding for an independent investigator to assist in review and evaluation of sensitive cases. Independent investigative power is necessary as check and balance to the police department. Yep. This is an interesting article, and it gets into a lot more details, and I highly recommend checking it out. And you can find all these articles both on the page and within the event.
Story if you want me to throw one in there. This is related to a grand jury decision this past week that I know that the local activists, including those with Black Lives Matter here in Houston, have been following. I'm pulling it up right now, just a moment. That's another grand jury decision from a couple years ago that HPD officer was cleared of. I don't want to misstate the guy's name, so I'm trying to pull it up real quick. But it was, you know, another decision here where the local police were involved with shooting someone, and there was no responsibility. No action was taken for the officer responsible. And I can't pull it out. I can't find it right now. But another story that is related to that is there was actually an officer, same thing. He, on camera, from the body camera, shows him shooting a 16-year-old kid who had his hand behind his back. And the guy happened to be white. And then I saw the story. I saw was saying how it sparked, like, White Lives Matter protests. These aren't the maybe these aren't the traditional White Lives Matter racist protests that we've been talking about here, that have been happening here in Houston with the people with their sort of what seemed like neo-Nazi imagery and language. But this was more in response, like, hey, a white kid was killed when he was obviously defenseless. So either way, I don't know. People, they're interesting with the way they're protests, but it's happening here in a local level in Houston. And I do know that Black Lives Matter and Sheree Door, who we've had on the show before, have been at the courtrooms recently doing grand jury watching and trying to, because grand juries themselves are a huge problem with that they're private and the information is never revealed to the public, you know, who is responsible, what the evidence was in these cases. So it's often very shady and suspicious.
For sure. I, got a couple of stories that tie in both with evidence and video.
Should we, before we go further, should we go ahead and just announce? Or?
Yeah, I guess so. We might as well announce. That way, or we can keep you in suspense and we can know.
We've got people waiting to listen. There's five people
who are
like,
you're going to stop tuning in. No,
we're keeping
you on
here.
No, you don't. Well, you'd carry this with you around with you everywhere.
I will say there was about 115 shares on
that. We can
do
better than
that.
Thank you. Thank you, but we can
do
better.
To everybody who shared.
We're playing good cop, bad cop here, okay? He's like, thank you, and I'm like, come on, 115 times.
I do think we can do better, but I think that's pretty
good
for the first week.
Yes, for sure. A lot of people didn't understand. They didn't understand, but they got it towards the end. It was like a race.
Next Monday and next the Monday after that and the following Monday, we're giving away these tickets.
We should narrate it like a race. In fact, in the lead, we early off, we got Jerry Carswell heading out towards the front.
We're gonna figure out how to do it. One of these is gonna be a little bit harder than just sharing. You guys got
We want you to work for it. This was easy. Yeah,
like you got
to
call in and maybe it's trivia, music trivia about some of the bands or political trivia. You have to choose.
Like what?
You
know? Well, when's Micah's birthday?
That's some interesting stuff. What if though you call, you know, say, okay, well, why do you want to be, you call in, right? And you're like, I want the Houston open air tickets. We're like, okay, which is the band that you are, you know, you want to see the most? And while you tell
and
us
if
that,
you get that wrong,
when you tell us that, we Google it up, information about the band, and then you got to answer a couple of questions, and you got to be, it's your favorite band or the reason you want to go, then you should be able to answer one question.
If you don't get to make it to the next round if you can't answer those. We don't even know if that's going to be the end. You might have to go through five rounds or something to finally get the tickets. But it's starting with you answering some questions about your favorite band.
But can I go ahead?
Yeah, go ahead.
All right. Now, some people would say this violates some rules. I don't think so.
Why'd you say that? What's wrong with you?
I don't think so. No, I'm just saying
the rules clearly on how somebody won. This objective contest.
Anybody is open to this contest, okay? Okay.
And if you only shared it to your page, thanks.
My brother shared this thing about 20-something times.
Dude, I'm sure it took him about 12 minutes.
That's the thing is, you didn't even have to share it that much. Before that, the most was 10.
Yeah.
Jeremy Carswell, thank you for that.
And we love Jeremy, but
and
goodness.
A few others I saw, people who aren't even Houston were sharing this, though.
Yeah.
So thank you.
Michael in Australia.
Yeah. That,
I mean, he's in Australia. He has no
hope of getting here, and he's sharing it, and you guys aren't. No, I'm just messing with you, but thank you to everybody.
Some of y'all did.
It.
A lot of people did. Like you said, it was shared 112 times, and that was a lot more than just our initial shares to get it out there and let y'all know. But now you know that's what's up, and we'll be asking, and that'll probably be some different type of contest that we'll have, you know?
So. Yeah, we're going to try to do some different things. As I said, a man by the name of Mikey Bro.
Congratulations,
Facebook.
Bro.
Bro.
He
shared it more times than anybody else. So thank you for that, and we'll be getting in touch. And this is, again, we're giving away a pair of tickets to the Houston Open Air Festival, Slayer, Ministry of the Cult, Of Mice and Men, Deftones, Max Cavalera, who anybody knows, who Sepultura, Soulfly, his new project, lots of different bands of hard rock, heavy, you know, some Slayer. Did we say Anthrax?
It definitely is a rock festival.
So we're giving you two free tickets to the whole weekend.
And the thing about it is, when we say two tickets, that's technically four tickets because you get both days, and they're selling the days independently. So this is a major score to get to go to both days and take your friend, see 35, the best. Through, I think, from the last four decades of heavy rock, you know, honestly. And they've got a lot of upcomers, you know, that I'm kind of interested in finding out more about. I've checked out some of them, and it's great to see that. I'm going to go ahead and say this. It's also, they're going to have someone local opening the show. It's a contest that they've got going on right now to find out a local band to open the show. So we'll get Mothership and all these other great regional Texas acts. But we'll probably end up with someone we all know opening Houston Open Air. So sweet. I'm looking forward to it. And we do have a lot of local news to get into. I got another death in the Harris County Jail that's drawing questions, it turns out. This one's a little different, but it draws in not just questions about death in jail, but also questions about cameras in jail. And this is a recurring issue, you know, and we've seen progress here and there. But yeah, let's get into this one just a little bit real quick here. It turns out, and I get the original source material here from Channel 2, there's a man, he was arrested on drug charges and he ended up dead. So, you know, let that be a lesson. Stay away from drugs. The family of the man, he died of meningitis while he was serving in jail. Yeah, about the CDC says when effectively treated, meningitis is only deadly like in less than 15% of cases. But this man was in Harris County Jail. And do you think he got effectively treated? I don't know. But let's get into it. Catherine Green, the mother of 27-year-old Patrick Green, other family members, and their attorneys gathered outside Harris County Jail last Wednesday to call attention to a lawsuit that they filed against the county. I hope this is another bad one where we end up paying a lot for this abuse. The bad side of the horrible void in our lives because Patrick is gone, Green said. Worse than that is not getting information. He was jailed in 2015 after he violated a probation for a drug charge. Who knows if it was a victimless crime or not. I'm not going to assume that it wasn't. The lawsuit, maybe he just tied someone down and injected a joint in them. I don't know. The lawsuit filed in federal court contends he was left without medical care for 2 days after contracting bacterial meningitis in jail. He died March 24th, just a few minutes shy of his 28th birthday. His mother said she spoke to her son on the phone Friday before his death and that he didn't seem like himself. She said her son called his grandmother 2 days later and told her he had fallen ill. He told my mother that his lips and fingertips were blue and he was very cold. According to family's lawsuit, attempts by fellow inmates to get him medical attention were ignored. Documents suggest Green began showing symptoms at least by Sunday, but wasn't transported to Bentob. Sunday, March 22nd, wasn't transported until March 24th, pronounced dead at 11:59 p.m. Civil rights attorney Randall Callanan, who is representing the Green family, says a surveillance video that would have shown Green asking for medical care inside the jail was destroyed. Despite the family request to then-Sheriff Adrian Garcia and jail staff to preserve evidence. You know, there could have been a crime right there, but, you know, we got to go ahead and destroy this. Okay, let's keep going. Harris County Sheriff's Office says the evidence requested does not exist. Right now, there is no one in government doing anything to investigate or improve medical care at the Harris County Jail, the third largest jail in the United States, Callanan wrote in his statement. The United States Department of Justice needs to step up its regulation of the Harris County Jail to prevent even more tragic deaths. Here's what Harris County Sheriff's Office sent out in their release. On June 15, 2015, the Harris County Sheriff's Office received a request for all video and audio recordings and photographs of the 3C4 pod at 701 San Jacinto, where David Patrick Green was housed from March 21st through March 25th. All video and audio recordings and photographs in the hospital, infirmary, clinic, and other facility at 701 San Jacinto or 1200 Baker, where Patrick received any treatment. Says, and all video and audio recordings and photographs at the dock where the EMS and Houston Fire Department arrived to load and transport Patrick Green to the hospital. No audio, video, or photographs ever existed of the described locations during the time period identified in the request. Has it ever existed?
Ever.
Yeah, no video, audio, or photographs were destroyed. There were no cameras in the 3C4 pod at 701 San Jacinto, where Patrick David Green was housed. There were no cameras in the hospital, infirmary, clinic, or any other facility at 701 San Jacinto or 1200 Baker, where Patrick David Green received any treatment. And there were no cameras at the dock, where EMS Houston Fire Department arrived to load and transport Patrick David Green to Bentob Hospital. Yeah, wow, man. So, yeah. So it's kind of interesting. And they've got a whole, yeah. I was going to get into this other part here. The family is basically concerned, you know, that, hang on one second, I'm sorry. Because there's a whole thing into this evidence being destroyed, you know, like whether these cameras really existed or not. And Randall Callanan is insisting that they, instead of preserving the evidence, destroyed it. Meanwhile, the sheriff's office is saying that there never were any. Callanan noted a Houston law firm hired by Green's parents alerted Harris County on March 25th that the family planned to bring liability claims for damages. The family's letter asked county officials to provide all evidence. He said two jailmates also told the family that Green repeatedly asked jailers for medical attention. Green's mother, who is also an attorney, said the county first told her they would ask the Texas Attorney General to allow them to withhold the records that she requested under the open records law. They are cherry picking and saying what wasn't there, but they are not denying there is video in the hallways and the vestibules where he made the request, if he did, for medical help. I know inmates said he made requests for medical help at least twice before his death. And it goes in deeper. So you got two different things going on. One about, and that's what I wanted, this is the one I was getting into. You got one about whether there's cameras or not, and you've got, you know, that side going on. And then on the other end, you've got this gentleman dying in jail of bacterial meningitis. And this gentleman was a graduate of Baylor University, had been in county jail for 3 months. He was arrested in 2014, and like I said, for a probated sentence for a drug possession, died as he waited transfer to a Texas prison to serve out his sentence. So, you know, a lot of things can happen in there. I guess you can get meningitis and not be treated.
It's definitely not, I mean, speak from experience, definitely not a good time to be getting sick while you're locked up anywhere, because you don't really feel like you're going to be treated with the best care or that anybody really truly cares. I hate to say that, but it's kind of true in some places.
Meanwhile, the Harris County DA is talking about the destroyed evidence. It turns out that 142 cases were dismissed and thousands of cases are under review because the basically, Precinct 4 Deputy Constable destroyed some evidence. Most of these cases were related to drug crimes. He destroyed the evidence related to drug crimes. How do they notice drugs aren't getting recycled then? You know, maybe they didn't destroy it. I'm just saying. But yeah, so yeah, how's that for effective? To date, 142 cases have been dismissed and 21,500 pieces of evidence have been destroyed. Also, 1,072 pending Precinct 4 cases that are not drug-related are under review. Yeah. So, yeah, got that going on, too.
Interesting stuff, man. I mean, it's definitely, there's a lot happening in our city. Like we were talking earlier with Oscar, there's protests happening over something happening in North Dakota. There's corruption in local police. There's grand juries ruling in ways that people aren't happy with. There's tons of issues and things that you can get involved in. I do want to invite those who are listening and maybe new listeners here in the city of Houston to check out the HoustonFreethinkers.com, check out our YouTube channel, listen to Freethinker Radio every Monday. We are planning on beginning having the meetings again for the Houston Freethinkers, maybe even this month, but more than likely October. As I've said before, myself and a couple others are working on trying to get a house together, do what we've done in the past, the Freethinker House, give us a space for meetings and community spaces for lots of different purposes. So we're still involved in the Houston community. We want to remain involved. And this, you know, just whenever something important pops up, we're ready to be out there on the streets, whether it's this Dakota pipeline or any other issue, you know, police violence or even just raising awareness on an issue. We've talked about doing other benefit shows, like benefit shows for human trafficking, which is also a huge problem here in Houston. So whatever your issue may be, whatever you're concerned about, because I will say that even the cool thing, Micah, about this, the pipeline action, kind of remind me of some of the other things we've seen in the past few years, because there was definitely a lot of people who'd never been active before out on the street last Friday and who were looking to meet other people and asking questions like, hey, what group is this? Or who's this with who? Or, you know, these kind of thoughts and questions because they were looking for people to connect. They're like, hey, this is my first time coming out. So it's been cool. And I'm hoping that those who are at that point and who decide to come out and get active are ready to do more and to find other ways to get active in whatever groups you're coming into contact with, whatever people you're working on. Hopefully you maintain a mentality and a thought of, you know, working together and of unity and of not divisive tactics, because there's a lot of that, unfortunately, in activism as well. But it's always good to see people come out and get involved when they're just fed up with what they're seeing in the world. And hopefully we can take that mentality and build upon that and build some coalitions, build some alliances. So, yeah, thank you to everybody who is choosing to be active in some way in the city of Houston and wherever you're listening from. You got another story? You want to go to a song?
Man, I got stories and stories and stories. But, yeah, I got it. Let me just wrap up Houston.
Sure,
and then,
then
we're done with Houston.
And we'll do a song and come back.
We'll have something beyond Houston plus three guests. That's pretty exciting. Very special day here on Freethinker Radio. This is from the Houston Press. Take what you want out of it. I'll make it fast. Houston police officer is accused of threatening his wife and others, I'll add, with a gun. Houston police officers faced several charges after police say he threatened to kill his wife at least twice, most recently, and after surprising her at her workplace. Just think of that when you date a cop. Police said Pedro Gonzalez, 45, showed up at his wife's work on August 25th and told her he would, quote, kill her and shoot up the whole building and turn it into a meat market.
Oh, gosh.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. And I think that's enough about that story. It goes on and on. You can get into it, but
you pretty much heard all you needed to hear.
Yeah.
Turn this place into a meat market.
Yep. And it goes on, you know, you can get into the details, you know. It's just another day. Actually, it wasn't a beatdown. It was just the threat of a beatdown or a meat down. One of the two. But yeah. Let's hear some music. Let's get into that.
All right. Well, let's hear. This is going to be a song from Murder Boss Death King.
All right.
We've played plenty of shows before for Visionary Noise and been on Freethinker Radio before, and we've played them before.
Yeah, so we had a solo project off the side of that, Soledad, on here as well. And yep. Murder Boss Death King will be out at Dan Electro's Friday.
Word. Awesome. Hey, yes. Micah, go ahead and post those links, those stories you're talking about
on that thing.
So all these great people can keep up. And if you guys want to call in for any time point during the rest of the show, 713-526-8737 to talk about anything we've talked about. Vaccines, the pipeline, Adam Kokesh's tour, local corruption, what's on your mind, feel free to call in to Freethinker Radio. That's 713-526-8737. And I do want to remind you, following this show, Addiction Free Radio with myself and John Vibes will also be on. So stay tuned for that. This is Murder Boss Death King. We'll be right back. We'll be right back.
Murder Boss Death King. And we actually have the winner of the pair of Houston Open Air tickets here with us. Hey, bro, what's up?
What's going on, guys? Mikey Bro here.
Good to talk to you, man. Good to talk to you. Congratulations on scoring the tickets. How do you feel about that?
Man, that's awesome. That's great. A lot of good bands going to be there.
Who are you most excited about checking out?
Deftones, most definitely. Seen them plenty of times, but I haven't seen Pierce the Veil or The Word Alive, so I can't wait to see those guys.
Nice, nice. Well, congrats, and thanks for helping getting the word out about that going on, as well as our program here. I take it you've been listening to the show today.
Yeah, you guys, great show today. I'm really enjoying it.
Nice, nice. Well, we appreciate that as well. So, hey, Derrick, talk to our...
Well, what do you... you said you've been listening a little bit. I just want to see if you had any thoughts on any of the topics that we covered. I know we covered a wide range of issues,
yeah.
But is there anything particularly that has, you know, stuck out to you?
Most definitely. When you guys first started the show, speaking about vaccines, I mean, that's something that I feel strongly about, just having kids. And I hate that these school districts are forcing children to have vaccines just to go to school. Just like the guy you're speaking to was saying, I mean, I feel the same way, you know, exercise and a change of diet and just trying to stay fit and healthy. I mean, it's just a lot of things that you could do aside from vaccines.
Have you been able to see that documentary that they were speaking about vaxxed? Have you seen that yet? I do believe it's available online now for those who are interested in checking that out, you know, and judging it for yourself, the story yourself. That's vaxxed, V-A-X-X. XXED, you can find that. They have vaxthemovie.com, I think. And also, I do want to say, just for full disclosure, you know, the other interview that you can find, I interviewed also the director and the producer, that's on youtube.com/consciousresistance, is with the producer, Del Bigtree, and the director, who's also Dr. Andrew Wakefield, who is controversial, and his work is, according to mainstream medical journals, his work has been discredited, that they were unable to replicate his study. He was the first person to find a link between the MMR vaccine and autism, and then that, you know, caused a bunch of controversy. That study was later, they said, discredited, and they couldn't replicate his results. So according to, you know, other people, he's just a liar and he's just trying to scam people, make money. And I got to interview and sit down and talk to him and ask him about that and how he felt about that. Maybe we'll even play that in a couple of minutes, because that's important as well. But I just wanted to throw that out there for people. There's definitely more than just one side of the story, but it does seem like no matter what way you look at vaccines, you have the vaccine court where there's billions of dollars allocated towards families that sue the whenever their children get hurt, because it does happen. And that's sort of downplayed. They don't really talk much about that. There's also the issue that, you know, the film's not saying that all vaccines are bad or asking people to just get rid of all the vaccines. It gave four little goals at the end, and it was saying, I think I mentioned this in the interview with Councilmember Christie, that said subpoena the CDC scientist who said that he's whistleblowing about autism connections and the study that he was involved. You know, until he's subpoenaed, they can't bring him in front of the court of law, and he can't say anything else legally. So do that, then, you know, get Congress to call for an investigation. Then they also wanted to separate the MMR vaccine and make them three separate shots at different times rather than three shots at one single time, which just seems to make sense to me. It doesn't seem to be, you know, they're not saying just abolish all vaccines or we think vaccines or whatever, you know, it's this extreme position. I think they're calling for some real basic things and to basically to bring shine some light on the vaccine injury fund and to get rid of the vaccine court, which is basically allowing, there's a law that allows that anytime, like say your children, Mike, were, you know, given a vaccine and something went wrong with them and you thought it was related to the vaccine, or even if you had proof, those companies are protected by law and they can't be sued. So
right.
It's definitely a huge issue. That documentary does a great job in talking about that. So if you haven't looked into it, we do recommend that. Anything else you want to say before we let you go? And we'll definitely get you those tickets.
I appreciate you guys, man. Thanks a lot, and I'll continue listening. I enjoy each and every show I listen to.
All right, thank you for calling in. We'll talk to you soon.
Definitely appreciate
right.
it, man.
All right, cool. Y'all have a good one.
All right, there. Got a winner. Got another interested individual going to Houston Open Air, and definitely listener of the show. So that was good to get some feedback from another person out there.
Go out there and You got to go out there and start sharing stuff. Are we going to do a share again? Should we say that?
I think we should. I think
we'll
we
give
should,
you guys
you know?
Another opportunity. Now that maybe you've done it for 1 week, you might have the better opportunity understanding of what
how
it
to
is.
Share.
Just share it on in groups that you're in. Share it on your personal page, telling people.
You can share it into events
to
too.
Do. You know, to just come to play. You know, to listen and you know to be a part of it. Share it anywhere you like on your own time.
See, this time we had some people starting out. They were like, they were moving. They were moving that first day, but then they just stopped. And then the next, there's 6 more days. There's 6 more days, and people are sharing. They're going and waiting at the bus stop and waiting for the bus and sharing into groups there. You know, I mean, look at the lineup. We've talked about it, but check it out. Go to HoustonOpenAir.com.
Yeah, thank you to everybody at Houston Open Air. Thank you to everyone at 90.1 KPFT Houston for supporting us and allowing us to do this and, you know, just provide something like music, information, knowledge, a voice, you know, for those who want to speak out and a safe place to do it. And if you want to get more involved, again, like I was saying earlier, check out the Houston Freethinkers on Facebook. Check out the HoustonFreethinkers.com. Look up for more events. Probably doing a benefit later this month for the Dakota Access Pipeline and raising awareness on that. And, you know, I think that's something that most people can probably get behind. It's not necessarily an attack on anybody who works in the oil industry, I would say, at least not from my perspective. And really, we're getting to the point where it's extremely cold out there and the people are camped out, you know, trying to make a difference in this area. And they feel like the best way they can do that is through direct action by putting their bodies on the line. And so it's about to get really
cold.
So
we can clean out some closets and get some jackets and, you know, warm clothes up to those people, perhaps, hey?
Absolutely. That's the goal. So we'll have more information on that as it develops by next week's show for sure. And I do want to throw this out as well, that there is this weekend, of course, is the 15th anniversary of the September 11th attacks. For those who may have just not noticed or not been aware. And I'm going to be going to New York City as I do typically every year. And I'll be coming back next Monday. I don't think I'll be here for next Monday's show. I think I'll get back pretty late. But when I do, when I am the following week, or even if I can maybe get it to Micah beforehand, I'll send some audio clips. I'm going to be doing interviews at this 2-day symposium that's taking place Saturday and Sunday. It's called the Justice and Focus Symposium. And there's going to be, as typical of these things, family members, firefighters, members of the Architects Engineers for 9/11 Truth, and lawyers, including Daniel Sheehan, who worked on the Pentagon Papers. He worked with whistleblowers. He's done a lot of different things. The former Italian Supreme Court judge, who also has questions about 9/11, openly spoke about that. The professor Leroy Holsey from the University of Alaska Fairbanks, who's currently conducting a 2-year study on World Trade Center 7 and trying to look at how the fire could have caused a collapse, and lots of different interesting things that, you know, aren't obscure, crazy, you know, conspiracy theories, is like people like to paint it, just, you know, a legitimate look into answers and trying to find, you know, the truth about this. So, I will be doing some live streaming this weekend. If you want to follow that, you can find that on Mint Press News, and I'll be telling everybody about that once I get back to the show. And like I said, maybe I can get Micah the clips and we can play that on air next week for you guys, so you can be informed of that, because I'm hoping to get some good interviews from everybody out there and bring that information back to you guys.
For sure, for sure. I got a couple of stories, and then the last two I got to really kind of lead into some of the subjects that you'll be getting into in your following show with John. But these, you know, one I meant to, I've been carrying this story for a minute. I didn't get to it last time. This is from the Wall Street Journal, an internet giveaway to the UN. Yep, that's right. When the Obama administration announced its plan to give up the U.S. protection of the internet, it promised the United Nations that it would never take, the United Nations would never take control. But because of the administration's naivety or arrogance, the UN control is the likely result if the U.S. gives up internet stewardship as planned at midnight on September 30th. This is bigger than Y2K. Yeah, we're going to give up the internet stewardship, you know? I mean, I don't know what I think about that. That could be good. That could be bad, you know? Sounds like there's some really scary parts about it, too.
It also helps people realize that the internet's not as free as a lot of people think, that there actually are people that have control over it.
For sure, for sure.
At least the World Wide Web.
One of the things they brought up that's kind of startling, also antitrust rules don't apply to governments or organizations operating under government control. In a 99 case, the second U.S. Circuit Court of Appeals upheld the monopoly on internet domains because the Commerce Department had set explicit terms of the contract relating to the government's policies regarding the proper administration of the domain system. Without the U.S. contract, I would seek to be over overseen by another governmental group so as to keep its antitrust exemption. Authoritarian regimes have already proposed ICANN become part of the UN to make it easier for them to censor the internet globally. So much for the Obama pledge that the U.S. would never be replaced by a government-led or an intergovernmental organization solution. Rick Manning, president of Americans for Limited Government, called it simply stunning that the politically blinded Obama administration missed the obvious point that ICANN loses its antitrust shield because should the government relinquish control, the administration might not have considered the antitrust issue, which would have been naive. It goes on. This is really an important thing that I kind of wish I'd covered earlier, but September 30th, we got the rest of the month to talk about this. Don't worry. We'll get into it deeper.
Yeah, no, ICANN is definitely a really important and interesting topic because, as I was saying, I don't think a lot of people understand that the internet is definitely free, and we were just discussing that the power of the internet spreading a message and such, but there are organizations and bureaucracies behind that can influence and change things and possibly limit traffic or change the way that you get the internet. So look into ICANN, I-C-A-N-N, two N's?
Yeah, two yeah. N's. Turns out that you might be wondering why you didn't get that mail from eBay. I know I've been missing some packages, but postal workers have been arrested for stealing mail, cell phones, and drugs. So if you're missing your cell phone or some drugs, you might want to check the post office.
Are you missing your drugs?
Nearly 36 people were under arrest. It turns out one of them had 48,000. Yeah, that's right. That's with 30 afterwards. 48,000 pieces of mail that were supposed to be delivered to customers. Yeah. And at least 166 stolen mobile phones. Yeah.
Huh.
Yeah, so think about that when you're using the post office.
Them post office.
I heard the price of a forever stamp went down. Oh, yeah. And now we're going to get into these two. The DEA, it turns out, is placing, say this name right, Kratom.
Yeah.
And Mitragynine on Schedule 1. Yep.
The same as they've done with LSD.
Yep. Schedule 1 is supposed to be no use at all.
No medical use, no accepted medical use, and like high addictive like potential or something like that.
Yep. And it turns out the various forms of kratom and teas made from the plant's leaves are sold in cafes, on the internet. Primary effect is to provide a short-lived, peaceful, and calm feeling that is described as pleasant. I guess, you know, we got to have that illegal, but let's get some alcohol, move in. But
it's just so crazy to me. I mean, really, I think some people who, especially those who kind of fight for cannabis legalization or decriminalization or whatever avenue you're fighting in, you see these various victories like, oh, this state passed this, or, you know, this city's doing this. And you think that maybe the government, especially the federal government, has finally gotten past the idiocy of trying to criminalize plants and free people in general from being able to do what they want. And then they take something else that is, you know, not a threat to anybody and say that they need to make it illegal and that now they want to be able to put people in cages. So they're going to create a black market, you know. And I mean,
North Carolina, it turns out, tried to deal with it a little bit differently, though. They did get involved, but they decided not to restrict it and not criminalize its use and not and sale, but to limit it to buyers over age 18.
I just don't think the restrictions are ridiculous.
You don't think they're ridiculous?
I mean, I just don't think these restrictions are ridiculous, and I don't understand why, like, it's just a ridiculous notion that people think that they can tell you what to put in your body in the first place. But then even more, like, I know somebody can out there and make an argument for hard drugs, crazy drugs, right? And sure, whatever. But a plant, you know, and the cannabis and kratom and they, you know, other psychedelic plants, like salvia is already gone, and that can be dangerous, yes, if people are using it wrong. But I mean, like, it's just, if you don't have cognitive
gasoline
liberty,
is dangerous.
I mean, everything's, you can huff anything, right? If you don't have cognitive liberty and the liberty and freedom to alter your state of consciousness, are you really free?
See, this is a part of, and I probably need to finish this, but when you were gone, I played half a Timothy Leary lecture from Harvard, you know, basically where he does come in and he says, you know, the laws of, divides into the laws of God and the laws of man, and basically what you put in your body, he takes it to be the laws of God. As long as I'm not out there doing something violent to someone else, then they have no reason to use, you know, these their laws you know, and infringe on that. But, you know, that's obviously one person's view. But, yeah. Oh, so I was going to get into one more. This one's a little bit more controversial. Yeah, I think that's pretty bad. You know, they're going to go ahead and move this thing as if it has no use. Okay, just because you don't see a use for it, does that mean it needs to be illegal? That's the other aspect. You see what I'm saying?
Who are you to tell me what I have use for?
Really? So it turns out also that there's going to be a gun ban for medical marijuana holders. How do you feel about that? Think about that. You basically don't have your civil liberties anymore if you use medical marijuana.
So you can't smoke cannabis and use weapons.
Not, you can't buy a firearm. It's legal to ban medical marijuana if you have a medical marijuana card. So this is
another way to catalog.
Yeah, but in Oregon, you can legally smoke pot, you know, for fun and medicinal purposes, no matter why you're using it. But it's basically, they can't do the ban there because they're not medical marijuana. See? So the places where it's absolutely legal, there's nothing to discriminate against people from, because the people who want to, you know, partake of marijuana don't have to go get a citizen card, a medicine card, you know. Does everybody who buys beer get medicine cards? What about the cigarettes? What about cough syrup?
Why do we all need cards and identification and all this kind of stuff? Why can't I just buy my own things and do what I want? Leave me alone!
Yes, for sure. But it gets into it, you know, and, you know, so that's something that I'm sure people didn't really think about, having those sort of ramifications. So,
yeah. Ramifications.
Unintended consequences of not just being so excited that they're getting what they think is legal marijuana, you know, jumping on the medical marijuana bandwagon and, you know, getting, you know, well, if it's a medicine, then you're prescribed it and, you know, you can maybe not be able to operate machinery like a Gatling gun or something. I don't know. It's very unfair. I mean, what if you really were a medical marijuana PTSD stressed out veteran and you wanted to go out there and celebrate, you know, you had your own, you went to a firing range. What, you can't like do that? And you, why can't you protect yourself? And why can't you stop the government? What, if you smoke too much pot, you can't have your Second Amendment to maybe defend America and your civil liberties, your neighbor's civil liberties against a totalitarian government? Why? Because if you smoke pot, you might realize that you have a totalitarian government. I don't know. You're going to get so high, you're going to think that you have a totalitarian
that
government.
That is true. You know, you start taking psychedelics and, you know, I'm not encouraging anything. I'm just saying when your mind is expanded in certain ways and used maybe with a more mindful purpose, you start just in general looking at the world differently. That might be dangerous. Free thinkers are dangerous.
Free thinkers are dangerous. Cannot be armed. Okay, yeah.
That's a line from a System of a Down song. That's where I first got that. Back some throwback to some old freethinker zines and flyers. It says freethinkers are dangerous. I got that from System of a Down. Shout out. System of a Down.
I wish they were on open air.
Dude, apparently I saw, this is just a little side note here, because, you know, we're music fans too. I just saw that they like tweeted out or Instagrammed or something a picture of them jamming for the first time in years. They haven't had an album out since 2005.
Wow, time flies.
So that's pretty cool. They may be making some new music, and that's what we need. We need important bands like that are willing to take a stance and make fun music and talk about real stuff.
That's one of the things with some of these bands, and during your absence, I tried to get into it, that some of these bands on open air, Ministry, they, you know, spoke out heavily against the wars, against Bush, you know, against New World Order. This goes on. Anthrax, you know, with different songs like Package Rebellion. You've got a lot of, you know, a lot of spirit of, I'm not going to take this in rock and roll. And these bands, many of them have a history of doing different songs that speak to that, including The Cult, Peace Dog, you know. It just gets, you know, so we're happy to be able to give these tickets out. And I guess we're going to wrap up today's show, maybe leave you with a song. I've been having a heck of a good time. I'm going to miss Derrick next week, but we'll be here. So tune in again, 3 to 5. Share the event. You'll see an event out there. I'm not sure what all we'll have going on, but we are going to give away tickets. We're going to talk more about that.
We're going to give tickets away, and I'll be back the following week. And we'll be continuing to give tickets away at the Houston Open Air Festival. So once again, thank you to everyone who called in, who listened to our guests today, and of course to 90.1 KPFT for always allowing us to do what we do. I'm going to close out with another musician here. This is actually, they're not local. It's something we do every now and then, but they are playing for the community. They were called Liberation. I just got word that now they're called Truth Universal. And this is some really cool stuff. This is called Fault. Have a good day. You've been listening to Freethinker Radio on 90.1 KPFT Houston. You are powerful. You are beautiful. You are free. Peace.
Don't forget it.
right? It don't add up. Have I lost my grip? Running in circles, trying to follow my bliss. How wrong I was. Engulfed in ignorance, blinded by love. Intentions were pure, intentions are meaningless. Intention is defeated in obedience. Misguided loyalty to the belief in authority. The belief in unconditional love. Become an individual, cut the umbilical plug. Just a bunch